Kate Bush has been a leading figure in music outside of this country since the late 1970s. Her many hit singles include Wuthering Heights, Breathing, and Babushka. Now the singer, songwriter, producer is enjoying her biggest American success with the single Racing Up That Hill, and it's off the album Hounds of Love.
The mid-80s was make or break time for Kate Bush. Since her breakthrough in 1978, she'd been gradually alienating her fans with successive, ambitious, but non-commercial left turns. As such, her label EMI was seriously concerned for her future as a pop artist. However, all that changed in 1985. She returned after 18 months at her farmhouse recording studio with her weirdness intact and a song about Faustian-deals, body swapping, and the power of love. And it saved her career. This is New British Canon, and this is the story of Running Up That Hill, a deal with God. ...1982 proved a turning point for Kate Bush. In September, she released her fourth album, The Dreaming. It was a conscious reaction to her previous album, and her career up to that point. She had released Wuthering Heights when she was 19, and since then she had continually evolved as an artist. On 1980's Never Forever, she delved further into her imagination and pulled out diverse layered characters, like the suspicious housewife of Babushka.
She wanted to test her husband, she knew exactly what to do.
The proto-Beatrix Kiddo with Sights and Revenge of The Wedding List.
I'm gonna fill your head with
Not to mention the fetus fearing for its life during nuclear winter on Breathing. Musically too, the military waltz of Army Dreamers. And string-themed rocker Violin. Showed that Bush could do more than eccentric piano ballads. Never Forever was also the first album by a female solo artist to enter the charts at number one in the UK. But despite all this, the general public still saw her as the helium-voiced girl who did interpretive dance on Top of the Pops of 1978. With The Dreaming, she hoped to change this perception. This is the first time that I actually enjoy listening to my voice. It's a big breakthrough. Though Never Forever was getting there, it was really compromised all the way, because I couldn't do any better at the time. I think it's the vocal cords as you get older, they do something. I can actually put some balls into my voice for the first time. It's exciting. Although the project started with a plan to hire David Bowie producer Tony Visconti, Bush ultimately chose to handle the production duties herself, with a little help from a few engineers. This itself was a significant step forward for her as an artist. Obviously, the production is such a big part of what the song is. It's every bit as much what the song is as the lyric, and I mean it is the song. With the majority of it recorded at the pricey Abbey Road Studios in London, The Dreaming was a move away from the orchestrated full-band pop sound of her early records, and onto a more progressive pop direction. This was aided by extensive use of the Fairlight CMI, a high-tech for the time sampler synthesizer. Features included a library of preset synthetic instrument sounds, and the ability to play melodies with self-recorded samples via its onboard keyboard, as well as rudimentary digital sequencing software. Having met the Fairlight on my last album, Never Forever, I'd realized it was invaluable for my music. What attracts me to the Fairlight is its ability to create very human, animal, emotional sounds that don't actually sound like a machine. I think in a way that's what I've been waiting for. Bush had first encountered the instrument through former Genesis frontman Peter Gabriel, who had used the device on his third self-titled album, known as Melt. She had provided backing vocals for No Self-Control,
lights go out, stars come down, like a swarm,
and Games Without Frontiers. Gabriel would be a recurring influence on Bush's new material. The only person I met who is really into the same kind of approach to playing as I do is Peter Gabriel. He seems to be working behind the scenes in a similar way. He's going for the emotional content of the music and lyrics, and he changes his voice. By the Dreaming, she was able to import her own Fairlight, previously having rented one of three machines in the UK at the time. Free to experiment, the LP was a chaotic cacophony, a vast array of textures, music concrete, and looped instrumental that she was in full control of, even if her early trials were less than stellar. Hugh Pagham engineered the first few weeks before moving on to co-produce The Police's Ghost in the Machine. I couldn't bear it after a bit, actually. She didn't really have any idea of the sonics, and didn't understand why, if you put 150 layers of things all together, you couldn't hear all of them. The whole thing with Gabriel is that everything had much more space around it. She would take 100 things and want them all to work together. She didn't really want to listen. As far as I was concerned, when we were doing those sessions, it sounded shit. Further tearing down what she had created before, she went for an irregular tom-heavy drum sound, similar to that of Susie and the Banshees and Killing Joke, but with gated reverb inspired by Gabriel. And Phil Collins in The Air Tonight. I always felt that there was this slightly sort of MOR quality to hi-hats. It just sounded a bit passé, so that was one of the key things. Make sure there's no hi-hats. This is most obvious in the tribal rhythms of lead single, Sat in Your Lap. Lyrically, The Dreaming was an uncomfortable listen. Themes of paranoia and unease with her fame. There are references to a TV documentary on the Vietnam War on Pour Out the Pin. Just one thing, be all and Australian Aborigine Land Rights on the title track. Less directly, Stephen King's The Shining and Ridley Scott's film, Alien, inspired the dark, paranoid, Get Out of My House. The Dreaming was an emotionally very intense, and often consciously aggressively sounding album, because it was about how terribly cruel people could be, what we do to ourselves, the amount of loneliness we expose ourselves to. It was a searching, questioning album, and the music did tear you from one point to the next. All in all, it took Kate Bush almost 2 years to record The Dreaming. The last 3 months coincided with the Falklands conflict, which further darkened the mood. Bush, engineer Paul Hardiman, and bassist and Bush's partner Del Palmer spent 15-hour days working out the album's final mix, subsisting on chocolate, cigarettes, and Chinese takeaways. The end result was a defiantly uncommercial album, and her label, EMI, were less than happy. Said Brian Southall, head of artist development at EMI at the time, "There is a clause in all contracts that gives the record company the right to refuse or return or object." From the conversations I had, that was the closest EMI got to returning an album in my time. The trouble was, you couldn't go back to Kate and say, "There's no 3-minute pop single on here." She'd say, "I know, I didn't write one." It wasn't part of her makeup to start with, but there was a danger of her falling off the radar. When it was released, The Dreaming entered the UK album chart at number 3, but was a disappointment compared to Never Forever's number 1 placing, and continued an unfortunate trend of each of her albums selling less than the last. As for singles, Sat in Your Lap had reached number 11, but that had been released more than a year before the album arrived. The Dreaming's title track, with its cod Aussie accent, was her lowest charting single yet, managing only 48, while third single, There Goes the Tenor, we got the job sized, failed to chart. 7 years later, she would be able to joke, "That was my She's Gone Mad album, my She's Not Commercial Anymore album." But at the time, things were not looking good for Kate Bush. Despite making some of the most innovative and challenging work of her career, she was in danger of being forgotten. And worse, this innovation was costing EMI almost a grand a day to produce. Unless her fortunes changed, her next release could be her last. For her fifth album, Kate Bush needed to switch things up. From a personal standpoint, a quarter of a year working endlessly without adequate nutrition was making her feel like shit. So too was her grimy London-based living arrangements. Her three-step plan for betterment involved buying a cottage around the corner from her parents' home in Kent, overhauling her diet, and most importantly, building her own professional standard 48-track studio inside her parents' barn. The same barn where she had written The Man with the Child in His Eyes when she was 13. And this is where she would create Hounds of Love.
The Dreaming, the album before, I'd never produced an album before that one. And because it had a lot of unfavourable attention from some people, I think it was felt that me producing Hounds of Love wasn't such a good idea. And for the first time, I felt I was actually meeting resistance artistically.
Having built her own studio meant that her long-form experimentation wasn't resulting in a long-form invoice for EMI. As much as they would have preferred her to be produced by a proven hitmaker, for this potential misadventure, they weren't going out of pocket. They could let Kate be Kate. After the demanding lands that my last set of songs took me to, I had to think again about where to go. Maybe somewhere a bit sunnier. Not soon after moving back home, with the countrified air in her lungs, and looking onto the neighbouring valley, Bush composed The Essence of a Deal with God in an evening. Inspired by Peter Gabriel's ways of working, instead of using her piano to compose, Bush would start out with the beat using a Linn drum machine. Making these newer songs, for the most part, less floaty, more rhythmic. By the time dreaming engineer Paul Hardiman arrived at Bush's barn studio, the key elements were all in place. It wasn't a demo, it was a working start, and we carried on working on the original. Dell had programmed the Linn drum part, the basis of which we kept. We spent time working on the Fairlight hook, but the idea was there, as was the wind train sound, and her guide vocal. It was obvious to me that Kate had finally found a groove. We worked a lot on the Fairlight part, which incredibly reminded me of the synth line in Atmosphere Strut by Cloud One. I was very happy to push the groove. Whereas previously her demos had been just that, demos. For this album, Bush wouldn't discard the original recordings, instead building on them. This way the original vocals and emotive spark wouldn't be smothered with repeat run-throughs. By the end of 1983, the majority of the album had been written, but far from the lightly orchestrated compositions of her debut, they weren't close to being complete. On A Deal With God, the punishing Linn drum pattern was augmented by Flesh and Blood playing from Stuart Elliott, former Cockney Rebel drummer who had played on all of Bush's records. When she became producer is when she started using musicians one at a time. Now the chemistry is between the individual musician and the track he's playing on. On A Deal With God, I did the doomph do basic rhythm over the machine beat. And the big explosive fills over the last chorus. It was a mixture of machines and human capacity. A Deal With God's main synth riff was written on the Fairlight, Bush most likely contorting and manipulating one of its cello samples to give the audio quality of a particularly squeaky window. But like an epic Notre Dame style stained glass window.
And there is something about the character of a sound. You hear a sound and it has a whole quality of its own, that it can be sad or happy, or and that immediately conjures up images which can of course help you to think of ideas that lead you on to a song.
The image that came to her mind upon composing that riff was one of a lover's quarrel being remedied, not via talking, but via a deity-fueled, Freaky Friday-style scenario. So that the couple could see from each other's point of view. The hill in question is their struggle to communicate.
I think it was perhaps an expression of freedom from the things that I'd felt before. But it's very much about love and the power of love. And the frustration of misunderstanding within relationships. And that if a man could become a woman and a woman a man within their relationship, that perhaps they'd understand a bit more about each other.
And that's the deal with God.
Yes.
The majority of her songs went autobiographical, mostly referencing books or films. But A Deal with God is as close to revealing the heart of Kate Bush as we would get. Her desire to swap places is a quirk of Bush's, and a motif found throughout her career, playing so many different characters as a means of seeing through their eyes, to empathize. And the song takes this and the troubled love pop song format to its logical conclusion. But the production extends this prayer for gender switch. Bush's last utterance, the vocal is pitch shift deeper. Like God has indeed agreed to the deal. This exploration of gender and walking a mile in their shoes within pop would be continued later in the 80s by Prince's If I Was Your Girlfriend. This kind of gender discussion within pop was ahead of its time, but that wasn't the reason EMI thought it would be barred from becoming a hit. The label argued that having A Deal with God as the title would prove controversial, pushing instead for the song to be released under the name Running Up That Hill. For me, A Deal with God is the title, but I was told that if I insisted, the radio stations in at least 10 countries would refuse to play it, because it had God in the title. Spain, Italy, America, lots of them. I thought it was ridiculous. Still, especially after the dreaming, I decided to weigh up the priorities. Not creatively compromise, but not be so obsessive that I had to give the album a chance. The concept behind album number 5 was split in two. Side A would consist of four big positive tunes to accompany opener, Running Up That Hill. The tying factor being love and relationships in their many guises. From the romantic coupling of Running Up That Hill to the father-son dynamic of cloudbusting. The A side, along with the album itself, would be named Hounds of Love. The title track was about being a fugitive of intimacy. The idea that to be in a compromised heart space was detrimental. The background vocals are to characterize the dogs hot on the trail. A metaphor for love that will literally tear you apart. The Hounds of Love are an image, really. Someone who's afraid of being captured by love. And the imagery is love taking the form of hounds that are hunting them. So they run away because they're afraid of being caught by the hounds and ripped to shreds. Alongside the storming android drums and scything cellos, a sample from the 1957 horror Night of the Demon sets the scene.
No! Oh, look! It's in the trees! It's coming! The demon! It's coming! No! It's in the trees! It's coming!
Furthering her Fairlight songwriting techniques, Cloudbusting's cellos are stitched together to fit Bush's martial stomp. But in a way that the seams aren't immediately present. If you listen carefully, the steam train effect at the end masks the song coming undone. all its elements falling out of sync from having no conclusion pre-planned. Cloudbusting was inspired by a book Bush had picked up before the release of their debut, Peter Reich's A Book of Dreams. It was written about his childhood and relationship with his father, psychoanalyst and philosopher Wilhelm Reich, whose experiments included the belief that he could make it rain with a device of his own invention, known as a cloudbuster. He would be arrested and imprisoned by the US government for his controversial theories, dying of a heart attack 3 months later. But every time taking the role of Peter, Bush utilized this intense emotion of being young and your father, your hero, being discredited and taken from you, and transformed it into a song. I can't hide you from the government. She had sent Peter an early version of the song as a way of asking his permission, and received a letter back giving her his blessing the day she was to record the main vocal for the song. Said engineer Hayden Bendel, he loved the idea of what she was doing. Recording her voice on that was just fabulous. We used to effects in the studio, and computer graphics in films. But when Kate stands in front of the microphone and sings, it takes your breath away. It's a huge privilege. She's quite softly spoken and laughs a lot and is very joyous. But she takes on these different personae when she's singing. She's an actress, as well as a singer. If the A side was the domain of the blockbuster singles, the other side was her, pushing her progressive pop to its limits.
Well, one of the first ideas I had was to try a concept. I've, for some time, wanted to play with a piece of music that was more involved than, say, 3 to 5 minutes. And I had the idea a good few years ago, but I'd never really put it into action. So it was really the concept side that came first. And I was a bit worried that it wouldn't work. So until I'd written, say, 4 or 5 songs, I wouldn't really know if it was going to be successful. So I thought it was wise to just use one side of the album so there'd be like half an hour to play with rather than going for an hour's worth.
The concept album was the domain of progressive rock, the 1970s likes of Genesis, Pink Floyd, and Jethro Tull. By the mid-80s, this was a derisively uncool practice. This was the era of MTV, stories told visually in 3.5 minutes. But her super literate pop music had always flirted with the influences, extravagance, and long-form storytelling of prog. Don't forget that Peter Gabriel fronted Genesis and the most space-addled. This was her chance to stand alongside them. Bush was wrestling with EMI wanting her to be famous and successful, and her own desire to make something true to herself. And side B, The Ninth Wave, is a testament to that. Bush's concept was the story of a woman caught in a shipwreck, lost in a freezing sea, desperately trying to maintain consciousness, as her lives, past, present and future, flash before her eyes. As a suite, it stands as Kate Bush's career high point. I was writing lyrics and we were right by the sea. I love the sea. It's the energy that's so attractive, the fact that it's so huge, and war films where people would come off the ship and be stuck in the water with no sense of where they were, or of time, like sensory deprivation. It's got to be ultimately terrifying. The concept is set up in And Dream of Sheep, her life jacket emergency light being the protagonist's only avenue of rescue. Little guide to me. As she feels icy death creeping in. Let me sleep and dream of sheep. One of the more obviously piano-focused compositions. The morbid lullaby is augmented by shipping forecast radio chatter and static. A simple cut and paste job nowadays. In the mid 80s, Bush would have to use the Fairlight to sample, sync and sequence those effects. No doubt she was inspired by the 1981 Brian Eno, David Byrne collaboration My Life in the Bush of Ghosts. On Waking the Witch, the protagonist relives a past life, that of a woman on trial for witchcraft, the drowning punishment reflecting her present-day predicament. Here, Bush embodies not only the one on trial, but also the accuser, adopting an almost demonic register. The most unnerving track in the suite. It stands as an evolution of her previous albums, Get Out of My House, and continues Bush's fondness for melding her pop with horror. Assuming multiple diverse roles, Bush was aided by one of her studio's unique qualities. There was no window from the mixing desk into the vocal booth. Said Brian Tench, who oversaw Hounds of Love's final mix, you couldn't see her doing her vocals. She enjoyed being in there and getting into her own world. Then she'd come out and say, how was that? And we'd all be sat there with our mouths wide open. By the time Kate Bush re-emerged in the late summer of 1985, she had been away for almost 3 years. She was kept in the tabloid press by rumours of significant weight gain, pregnancy, or rehab hell. In her absence, Madonna had released her first two albums and laid claim to the Queen of Pop title. Her blatant, in-your-face sexuality contrasted against Bush's sensual femininity. In the 3rd of August issue of NME, they ran a Where Are They Now feature on Kate Bush. 3 years since her last top 20 single, a half decade since breaking the top 10, is an eternity in pop music. Was Kate Bush in danger of being forgotten? On the 5th of August 1985, Bush performed her new single, Running Up That Hill, A Deal With God, on Terry Wogan's BBC One television chat show, Wogan. A week later, it had gone number 3 in the UK singles chart, her biggest hit since her debut. The album, Hounds of Love, would shoot to number 1 in the UK, knocking Madonna's Like a Virgin off the top of the charts, and prove she was back in business. Because Kate Bush toured once and only once, the promotional budget was instead pumped into 4 high-budget music videos in an attempt to break her on MTV. She also threw herself into a cycle of interviews and television appearances, her biggest media push since her debut. But Bush was never the biggest fan of the circus. I do get a bit scared of the exposure, coming out of work and saying, here's the new album. It's a bit frightening how exposed you are, suddenly everywhere, being on the side of a bus when it goes past. I hate that. Not only was Running Up That Hill and Hounds of Love a return to form in the UK, but they would further Kate Bush's success in America, both reaching the top 30 of the Hot 100 and Billboard 200 respectively. EMI wanted to cash in on this by releasing the whole story, to date Kate Bush's sole best of album. This just happened to coincide with her star further buoyanted by Don't Give Up, her duet with Peter Gabriel from his 1986 multi-platinum album, So. For Bush though, the biggest success was having proven herself in the eyes of EMI, so they could never again pester her for a new album. The sensual world would arrive 4 years after Hounds of Love, while it would be a further 4 years before the release of 1993's The Red Shoes. Ariel would then appear 12 years after that. 50 Words for Snow, her latest, was released in 2011. While the press had painted her as a recluse, since Hounds of Love, she's been in the position where she'll only release music on her terms. Hounds of Love's influence materializes in myriad forms. Imogen Heap, British indie-tronica artist, once said, when I was 17 and getting my first record deal, it was the likes of Kate Bush who contributed to labels taking me seriously as a girl who knew what she was doing and wanted. I was able to experiment and left to my own devices in the studio. Kate produced some truly outstanding music in an era dominated by men, and gave us gals a license to not just be a bird who could sing and write a bit, which was the attitude of most execs. Other inventive singer-songwriter and alt-pop types that followed Kate Bush's lead include PJ Harvey, Tori Amos, Björk, Bat for Lashes, Patrick Wolfe, FKA Twigs, Joanna Newsom, and Goldfrapp. There's also Cloudbusting's Hopeful Hook, sampled on Utah Saints' Something Good. The Futureheads getting a top 10 with their interpretation of Hounds of Love. Talk Talk cribbing A Deal with God's drums for Life's What You Make It. Or the many diverse covers of Running Up That Hill. Even Coldplay's Chris Martin has admitted that Speed of Sound was a subtle ripoff of Running Up That Hill. That's a song where we were listening to a lot of Kate Bush last summer, and we wanted a song where we had a lot of tom-toms in it. I just had my daughter up also, and was kind of feeling in a sense of awe and wonderment. So the song is kind of a Kate Bush song about miracles. Running Up That Hill endures because it is the sound of compassion. Wanting to know how someone else is feeling, to share that pain, is far more complex than the usual I love yous of pop music. But that's always been Kate Bush's role, as an emotional detective, making deals with God in an attempt to understand the human condition. Do you want to know how it feels? Because Kate does. Thanks for watching. So what is your favourite era of Kate Bush? More into Wuthering Heights or Hounds of Love? Let me know by commenting down below. If you like this video, like, subscribe, and why didn't you also do me a favour and share it with a couple of people? It really does help. Also, I'd like to shout out all my supporters over on Patreon. Thank you so very much. And I'll see you in less than 2 weeks' time for some percussive recalibration.